Grief is real, big, better shared. The podcast everyone needs to hear, but nobody wants to hear.
I'm Diane Brockmeyer, the CEO of Mid-America Transplant, and we are honored to sponsor this episode of Grief is Real, Big, Better Shared. At Mid-America Transplant, we have the privilege of working with families across southern Missouri and northeast Arkansas who choose to donate their loved ones' organs or tissues. While donation often brings families comfort, they are still heartbroken by their loss. We are proud to work with the Center for Good Grief and appreciate everything they are doing in the region to help bring healing to people who are coping with loss. Grief support is especially meaningful to me, as it was a tremendous help to my daughter, who lost her dad when she was 7 years old. 20 years later, she still recalls the positive, safe feelings she had with her grief support group. They understood her. Mid-America Transplant is inspired by life and by the donor families who give transplant patients a second chance. For more information about becoming a donor, visit sayyesgivelife.org.
We're going to jump back to the conversation that we started last week about men and grief. So talking about grief and kind of these messages, you know, maybe that you received as a child and how that impacted your grief journey, where have you felt safe with your grief? And I appreciate all of you have really said nice things about the center, but, you know, were there other people or places that you felt like you could be real or you could kind of let some of that other stuff down, or was it hard to find that?
I think it's very difficult, you know, because even, you know, the most well-intentioned loved ones, friends, colleagues, you know, they want to present themselves to be a listening ear and to be a support system. But at a certain point, you feel like you're laying it on them, mm-hmm. in a way. And you talk about, you know, lamenting. And that's been key for me, too, because, you know, with me, I would make sure my little ones are, you know, off the bed or something like that. And then I'll either go up to the rooftop or go down or go outside on the balcony or somewhere. And then I would have my moments, mm-hmm. you know, me and God have had some knockdown dragouts, mm-hmm. you know, through this process. And I can proudly say that, you know, every time once I get it out, you know, I hear this spirit saying, go back in there, look at those two children. Are they sick? Are they hungry? You know, are they safe? You know, do you have everything you need to provide for them? And this is your role, right? And this is why you're here. This is why they're here. And there's always this reassurance after I wear myself out lamenting. Sure. But is there someone that you feel like you can completely open up like that to? I haven't gone 100% mm-hmm. open up with anybody outside of Aaron, mm-hmm. right? I mean, I tell Aaron all the time in our sessions that I'm this is a lifetime contract you and I are signing, right? Like you're with me now. Like we're in this. And you know, and she always nods and shakes her head. But I feel like I needed her as that one person. That's why the center is so important, because, you know, you guys are not only trained, but you are human beings too. And I needed the one person in this world that I could just completely open mm-hmm. up to mm-hmm. and who would be objective and say, okay, now let's unpack this, let's organize it, and let's try to do it the best way possible to help you towards your healing. Mm-hmm. Because everyone else that you're that close to has a subjective view of you and your situation, not necessarily as much objective as possible.
And sometimes trying to make you hurry up and be better kind mm-hmm. of at the speed that they want.
Yeah, it's funny. I would say mine's a little different take on it. The center for me is a good place to open up and pursue things that I don't see. So tools I don't know I need or how to use them or things if you thought through this and you don't see how this is affecting you, like super. And then I'm super open with my wife, Dana. We have been real intentional about putting a lot of work in for our family. And I'm very grateful for that. And I've got friends. And it's just funny, as you're talking, I'm sitting here thinking, And I don't have 100%. And even if you combined everybody that I had to talk to, nobody's getting 100% as a whole. There is no fully open. I would love for it. And that would be, I mean, I think that's a goal. But I also can sit here and tell you, I can name some stuff where I'm not 100%. And it's just interesting because I'm like, you know, I don't know. That's just kind of, I don't know if I'm choosing, obviously I'm choosing, but I don't know if it's like a conscious choice to hold back or not or whatever. And so, and I have been, I think this is a safe place to say this, I hope. Even my friends, those relationships have changed a lot, and they, maybe my expectations aren't realistic. And so, I'll just leave that there.
But relationships change while we're grieving.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. All of them have changed 100%. And but they don't. I mentioned to Angela recently, I wish there's a book I'd like to write sometime that's the questions I wish people would ask. Hmm. And like, I would love to go around to people and you tell me what questions are people not asking you that you don't have to answer it, but what would you like to be asked? And I have questions that I wish people would ask that no one does. And I mean, it's not their fault. I mean, you know, but. So that's right.
Can you give one or two?
Yeah, I was like, what are some of these questions? Because I think it'd be great to share those.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I don't think anybody's ever asked me to talk about the experience of what it was like to hold either of my daughters, like as they were dying. I'll leave that there. Because the second question I was going to say is I don't have a lot of people ask me, like, when do you have tears flow like crying? And so I'm not going to...
So you have not been asked about crying. Yeah. I mean, I've heard that,
Angela,
from other men.
But I mean, Angela, we've been meeting together and you may have asked, and like, I can say that and like, maybe people have, and I don't hear it, you know? I mean, it's on me. I'm not at all projecting this out. But
No, but I think that's great because I've heard that from other men say, people will ask my wife or my daughter or my mother, but they don't ask me.
Yeah, but it's a scary question because if you ask me that and my answer, if I was to answer that, mm-hmm. is incredibly embarrassing. Mm-hmm. I mean, not something I'm proud of. So, what do you want to be asked?
Well, I mean, you know, and the reason why I asked, you know, to share a couple of them was because I didn't expect, the first thing mm-hmm. you said was the most intimate thing that I experienced, right? Mm-hmm. No one has ever asked me, what was it like to hold your wife's hand as she took her last, like, mm-hmm. If I ever write a book, that's chapter number one, my last date with my wife as she took her last breaths and what that moment was like. And no one will ever have, I don't know if anyone would ever be brave enough uh-huh. to ask that because that's the most intimate thing anyone could ever ask. Mm-hmm. But I would love for someone to, and that would allow me
right.
to give me that path. So for you to even share that, mm-hmm. you know, people think that some of those things are taboo. You know, I mean, no one wants to talk, you know, wants to think that someone wants to talk about a dying moment. But for me, in my situation, man, it was the most painfully beautiful thing that I could ever have experienced. I felt God's presence. I held my wife's hand and I felt like God had her other hand while I led her to him. And I can paint a picture of that day and how everything played out. So for someone to ask me that, they would really get a window and a picture into my soul to really know what this feels like.
Well, and you've just given us a beautiful glimpse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's amazing. Mm-hmm. I appreciate you sharing. I mean, it is.
Yeah.
And I also, I mean.
So thank you for asking.
Love it, brother. And it is important for me to remember that's a deep question to expect or hope someone, for someone
yes,
to ask.
Yes,
that's a
yes.
good point. You pointed that out.
Because a lot of times people will say that I'm afraid I'm going to, if I ask that, cause some people ask me, this is a very just question I get asked frequently. What can I say or what should I ask? And I will encourage people to ask real questions. And they're like, oh, no, no. I mean, this is really the number one response. That's going to make them sad. They're sad. Mm-hmm. Well, but if they're having a good day, let them share their story. These are the most intimate moments.
Yeah.
And they're oftentimes finding that I have no one who wants to hear these moments. And I so appreciate that realness. And I hope that people who are listening, I think that is something that people can really, really learn from this because you have given people the invitation, ask us these questions.
And be ready for the answer.
And be ready,
be
for,
ready
the
for the answer.
Right. But it's a beautiful answer. It's a beautiful answer. Right, I mean, right. Yeah.
But I think that these kinds of conversations are so challenging to have. So how do you even start launching into a challenging conversation? And people may not be prepared for that answer. And then how do you respond back to something like that? I'm a broadcaster, and it's hard for me to be able to know what to do with dead air, right? So you're constantly kind of thinking about what's the next thing that's going to be. And I think that some people may think that while they're trying to be genuinely, you know, Michael, when they're trying to be genuine to you, they may fear or be afraid that it comes across as either insensitive or something that is going to offend you or something like that. They don't see it as a way that you can provide some relief or some release that you desperately need to be able to help you in your grief process, because that's a challenging conversation to be able to have.
Well, and I'm going to throw out there also, because we could do a whole other podcast on stupid things people say.
That's the next question.
Amen.
Give me I need
give
eight
me
more hours.
Give me one or two. Give me one or two more.
Of those, brother. But that doesn't mean, I don't say that to discourage people from reaching out. And so what I usually encourage, where I would strongly encourage anyone, is learn to sit in silence. And I think the best example is in Job. He has his friends come, and what do they do for the first 7 days? They sit there and they'll say a word. Mm-hmm. It's when they start talking that they go off the rails and become fools. Mm-hmm. And I just encourage people, just go sit. Mm-hmm. Just go sit. Shut up and be present.
And it's okay not to have the answer.
Mm-hmm. Because we don't.
Because we don't have
the
answer.
We don't.
How do you answer something like that?
No. It just seems like people, when they say those stupid things, they're trying to make things better. And I remember I had someone who said something, I can't remember. They're trying to say, well, you know, you did everything you could for years. You know, you shouldn't be sad. And I'm like, look, my son is dead. That's not going to change. And I'm going to be sad probably forever about that. And I think if people would focus more on trying to just understand and not fix and not try to change a situation that's unchangeable. I mean, it's anyone who's around me for any amount of time knows I'll start quoting Al-Anon slogans. But, you know, one of the most damaging things you learn in Al-Anon is unsolicited advice. People who are telling you how to fix your addict, you know, this is what you should do. You shouldn't do this. And, bottom line is they don't understand. And so I found grief is a very similar dynamic to it, that, you know, you may have had other people in your life pass away, but that grief's not my grief. That's your grief. And that if you're going to talk to me based on your understanding of your grief, we're likely to have a disconnect somewhere, and you're likely to say something that's not going to be helpful. In fact, I think I said that with my wife a lot after talking with people and having those conversations is, you know, that's just not helpful. They're not being helpful. I think that's a great point about the book of Job and sitting in silence. The friends that I've been able to count on in my grief are the ones who say the least, but just let me know they're there. Mm-hmm. I'd say, I'm sorry for your loss. I know this has got to be tough. Yeah. That's all they say.
I try to be forgiving of these people. I mean, I think generally speaking, everyone who's, I've had to learn, they're coming from a place of trying to love. So it's not their fault. However, just show up,
right,
and stop talking.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think it's another phrase is you take what you like and leave the rest. Mm-hmm. And I found I leave a lot. Mm-hmm. I don't take a whole lot.
I think I tend to startle people sometimes because, again, I get asked this a lot, like, what should I do? And I've just learned, instead of like launching into some eloquent something or other, I'll say, zip it. And they sort of look at me like, wait, I was expecting some flowery. I'm like, just close your mouth.
Because it seems like that what I heard was a lot of what I would call throwaway phrases, especially with my mom. And let me give you a little bit of a perspective. even my dad and I have different frames of reference when it comes to what happened to my mom.
Sure.
And what I heard a lot of people and a lot of well-meaning people who I love dearly, including some of my family members who I love very, very much, they knew about the pain and suffering that my mom was in. And there was no doubt from the morning, from the time that she woke out of bed, you know, she couldn't feel anything but pins and needles from her hips all the way down. Mm-hmm. She battled infections. She had to go through dialysis daily, and thankfully she was able to do home dialysis. But, I mean, even it took her more strength to be able to just kind of get out of bed than it does. I mean, we just take it for granted mm-hmm. that that's what happens. But for my mother, it was the struggle was real. And what I heard from a lot of people, and even talking to my dad, and as I said, he's like my best friend, right? He has a different perspective of this. And we were actually talking about this the other weekend. And I was telling him how I still wish that I had mom back, because I miss now the times that I wish that I had to be able to just laugh with her and to be able to hold her hand and to be able to tell her, you know, how I felt and just to try to do whatever I could. And I said, I wish that I had that part of that back. Now, what he's thinking of is the caregiver. Mm-hmm. And he's thinking about all the times that he had to help her on a day in, day out basis. And he told me, he said, if you would have seen what she went through daily and the struggles that she had, he said, if I could bring her back and she didn't go through all of those struggles and all of that pain and all that, he said, I'd have her back in a minute. But if bringing her back meant that, Dad said, I would just let her go because she's in heaven, you know? Mm-hmm. And so the perspective is different. And I heard a lot of that from well-meaning people who said, well, at least your mom is not in any pain anymore. But I'm in pain.
Right.
It doesn't help me any.
Right.
And I heard that a lot. So for me, it was like a throwaway phrase. And I know they meant well, and I was not angry at them. But that was one of the things I told Miss Rachel. In my point of view, that didn't give me any kind of comfort mm-hmm. because I still want her back, you know. And so maybe, you know, and one person said, well, you're being a little selfish, aren't you? Because you would be bringing her back in all that pain. And I'm here thinking, no, I don't think that I'm selfish.
Yeah.
I want that person just so I could say one more time. And I know that's not coming back. And so trying to deal with
right.
that has been a real challenge.
And that perspective is so important. You know, even if we were all related and we were grieving the same person, we're going to grieve differently. And because we have different experiences, different memories, different thoughts, different just how we're wired. So that is so important, especially with our families. I know even in my own family, there have been times, and I'm a grief counselor, right? I'm like banging my head against the wall, like, why aren't they grieving like me? So that's just, that is so important. And but also just the messages I hear, hearing you, you know, I hear the joking about this is the book I would write, but it's a real book. And it's one of the best things that we do with our teenagers and kids. They love this activity is we just get out a giant piece of paper and we're like, all right, let's do it. What are all the stupid things people have said to you? And at first they sort of look at you like, really? And I'm like, come on, I know you got them. And they find, I mean, it's this weird level of comfort of like these terrible things, again, well-meaning usually, but like, oh, somebody said that to you. Somebody said that to me too, you know? But so talking about these things that people have said that are not helpful, also with where I think you were going is that sometimes it's not just the words. Sometimes it comes with a slathering of guilt, like maybe I wasn't already caring enough over here. You have now just slapped some more guilt on me or some more, you know, other feeling.
Well, and you're also dealing with someone who my mother would have loved to have talked to me 24 hours a day, seven mm-hmm. days a week if it could have been. But, you know, I'm married. I have a child, you know, work responsibilities,
right.
all these things. They live in... Dad lives in Mountain Home, so they were about 3 hours away. And so You know, there was a lot of things that just kind of go on there. And so sometimes I can still hear mom say, you know, well, you should have, I just love to hear from you. And you should have, you know, called me a little bit more. And mm-hmm. I wish you would have. And I'm here thinking now, yeah, maybe I should have. Right. But it's hard to kind of balance right. some of those things.
Are there any other thoughts about some of those not helpful, stupid things that people have said to you, or just even your experience with it? It sounds like most of these things kind of shut you down. Was there anything else anybody kind of wanted to address about that?
I mean, I think we've pretty much talked about, you know, the different layers, mm-hmm. right? I mean, there are people who are on the, you know, the outside that are sort of passersby, mm-hmm. and typically those kind of insensitive things, unintentional, will happen mm-hmm. at that level. Mm-hmm. You know, most people who are, you know, within the circle, you know, they're willing to stick through it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And sometimes they catch it themselves. Mm-hmm. Oh, you know, I didn't mean to say this or it. Mm-hmm. But I'm thankful for those people who are within the circle, because, you know, it takes tremendous courage to run towards a fire. Right. And, right. And emotionally, when you're grieving like we tend to grieve, regardless of who we lost, that's not an easy person to be around, mm-hmm. because you don't know. Right. You're trying to search for, OK, how can I best do this or do that? And the answer is just be mm-hmm. right. Just be. And then let the needs surface organically. Right. OK. So if you just go and show up, you know, I know. You know, a couple of people who came by our home, and they would notice, oh man, you're out of milk. The kids are going to need cereal in the morning. Let me run down to Kroger and get you some milk. Mm-hmm. I'll be right back. And that's stuff that I wasn't even thinking about.
Right.
But they noticed what the needs were.
Right.
And they just started addressing those needs. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you got to thank God for those people who can come in and see those things and be open-minded enough to be willing to help.
Yeah. Well, if we were going to write the opposite of that book, which I think that book is important, All the Stupid Things. But if we were going to write the guidebook, like how to help a grieving person, in this case of this podcast, how to help me as a grieving man. I mean, I think we've already touched on this. We've already said some things. But what else, what would the other chapters in that book be? What is important for people to know?
I would title one, It's Okay Not to Be Okay. That's what I would title one. And that's been the biggest thing that mm-hmm. I have learned from Miss Rachel mm-hmm. and from the center, is that, you know, you're going to go along some days, you're going to have a good day, and then there's going to be a grief bomb that's going to hit somewhere, and it's going to wreck the rest of your day. And you come home and you're, you know, upset, and you don't mean to be snappy at home, but sometimes it just happens, mm-hmm. you know, and so I'm still trying to navigate that mm-hmm. because my wife doesn't deserve to be snapped at. But how do you sometimes, you know, mm-hmm. deal with that? And so that's what I would say, is it's okay mm-hmm. not to be okay. And it took me a while to be able to get to that point to realize that. Because there, for the longest time, as I said earlier, I was thinking, what in the world is wrong with me? Mm-hmm. How come my spiritual life is not as strong as it was before? Because I wrestled with this whole thing of really being strong with the Lord. I was at a Christian concert the Sunday before she died. And now anytime I think about that concert, mm-hmm. I think about, man, if I just wouldn't have gone to that concert, I could have spent one more weekend with my mom. But how did I know that?
Right.
And so it seemed like when that happened, I felt like I had drifted so far away spiritually from God. And so it's been like a struggle to try to figure out myself emotionally, spiritually, and all that. And I'm still trying to figure some of that stuff out, because I don't feel like I am the same person. You know, I think mm-hmm. C.S. Lewis had called it an amputation. Mm-hmm. It was like an amputation.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And it does. It feels like a part of you is just being cut out.
Yeah.
And how do you get back to that point? And I don't know if I'll ever really get to the point of being able to say that, yeah, I mean, I know that she's gone. Mm-hmm. It's a head heart issue.
Mm-hmm.
Your head knows it. Your heart still deals with it. I mean, just an example, and I promise I'll be quiet. I was at she was cremated, and I was at the niche, the other weekend, and I spent some time there, and I kind of felt guilty that I was leaving her. And I said to Dad, I said, now, I know this doesn't make any sense. I know that she's in heaven. I know her ashes are there. But it took me the longest time to walk towards the car. And I was like, why, you know, why is it like, I felt like I was leaving her, you know?
Yeah.
And so it's those little things that I'm trying to work with to be able to, but I have to keep saying to myself, it's okay not to be okay.
I like that title. It's okay to not be okay, especially when everybody wants us to be okay. I mean, even maybe a little blurb to that, but what other titles of this book that I think we're going to have to write?
I would have a chapter called that would be titled Listen, Really Listen. Because I think that's one of the things that I really was craving, especially early in the journey, was just to have someone to listen. And Hannah supplied that really well, but it also highlighted how a lot of people just want to talk. They don't want to listen. And that you'd say something that'd make them uncomfortable, and instead of just kind of being quiet and taking it in, it was like, well, here's a counterpoint to that. Yeah. You know, this is why you shouldn't feel sad, or this is what you should do, or what you should stop doing. And listening to me is such an underrated skill set. Especially when it comes to grief and being with friends, family, that sort of thing. It's, but it's so when you feel really heard, that's a lot very comforting. It's been very comforting to me for those people, those friends that I have. My wife's that way, that when I'm feeling really sad, really in the midst of grief, and I say, you know, today's a really hard day for me. And it's just nice to have someone go, okay.
Or to even pause, because maybe you have a second thought that you might get to about, I'll tell you, I mean, we are not perfect at the centers, but in hiring therapists to work with us, we have to look for all those things. We have to try to find the therapists that are not the quick fixers. And sometimes that's hard. I mean, sometimes we have to talk about, you know, because a lot of times in typical mental health, it's goal-oriented. Like, we have a care plan and we have a goal. And, you know, again, they're your shoes. They're not mine. I have to join you where you are, and you can tell me what the goal is. And that's hard. I mean, it's a very different shift of thinking. That's why not everyone is a grief counselor, you know, because.
Yeah. And that was something Hannah was really good at, is especially early, I had just so much that was just flowing out because she was that safe, first safe place. And I would be watching, we're here on Zoom or on Teams, or I can't remember which one, but I'd be looking at her and she would just have a very neutral expression and just be sitting there and nodding along with me. And I'd even pause because I'm kind of anticipating she's going to say something. She would just sit there and kind of take it in. And it was, you know, there was a little anxiety because I wanted to hear something.
Right.
I wanted her to tell me how to fix the grief a little bit.
But
there was a comfort in it as well, is that I'm really being heard. Someone's really like letting this sink in. And I know that the response is going to be meaningful as a result.
I dreaded the sessions at first, but I'll tell you, I looked forward to them every week as it went along. And I think you're exactly right about this kind of going over, because it seemed like for a couple of weeks, I was feeling guilty in a way, because I felt like we were covering the same ground over and over and over again. The guilt, the all these other things and all that. And you want to talk about just patience and people who are willing to listen, Miss Rachel. Was that way. And I'm so thankful for that.
And that's an interesting point, because sometimes when men, you know, again, I'm not trying to be super stereotypical here, but with clients that I've had in the past, you know, I have to sort of assess, because sometimes men come and they want me to tell them step one, step two, step three. And then, but I can't categorize every man that way. And so, you know, because some really want the recipe, and I have to sort of break the bad news that there is no recipe, you know, that this is very individualized. And but we make the promise and the commitment that we can, we'll do it with you. Any other chapters that should be in that book?
Mine would be, and you guys came up with some fascinating chapters, and I'm sitting over here trying to get creative like you guys are. Mine would simply be, you know, in my situation, daddy cries too.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Daddy cries too.
Yeah.
And, you know, it took me a while to understand that, you know, my kids needed to see me cry.
Yeah.
They needed to see me weak. They needed to see me as a man feel the same and show the same sort of impact that, hey, I'm not a rock. I'm not a mountain, right? Yes, I'm trying to take care of everyone, and yes, I'm here to make sure you're okay. But I would have this ritual that I would do, you know, at nights, and they, you know, they would sneak out of bed and come back to the to the living room. So I would put them to bed, and then I would go and sit in our, we had this big floor-to-ceiling bay window, and overlooking the bridge and on Riverside. And I would put on LaShawn and I's playlist, like the songs that we always love together to listen to, slow songs. I would pour two glasses of wine, and I would sit looking out, and that would be my time. So after a few weeks, the kids realized, okay, this is daddy and mommy's time. Mm-hmm. And they would sneak out unbeknownst to me, like, because my back is to them. And that's when I would listen to music, drink wine, and I would cry. Mm-hmm. And one day they told me, hey, Dad, we know, we saw you. And once they did that, I said, okay, next time you guys can come out and sit with me. And that made them feel like they were comforting me.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm dad, I'm supposed to be the strong guy and making sure, but they were empowered to know that they were helping me. And so daddy cries too. And that's for the little kids and the big kids.
Absolutely.
You know, my daughter, my 22-year-old twin daughter, you know, she would just send, you know, randomly a Starbucks gift card, because that's what me and mom would do after our morning runs and walks. We would end up at Starbucks, and she, you know, she wanted to continue that. Mm-hmm. And that was her way of saying, Dad, make sure you continue to get out and do your run and do those things. So, you know, showing vulnerability as a man is, as you talked about, the stereotypes. Mm-hmm. But, you know, daddy cries too covers all of that. And that's the chapter I would try to write.
That's a beautiful picture. That's a beautiful picture.
Thanks.
And I love that chapter, because that chapter shows your strength to your children. And because if daddy cries, it's okay if I cry. Because I love my dad. I look up to my dad. And if I see him cry, then it means it's not so weird when I do it.
Yeah. And it shows them, hey, daddy really loved mommy too.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, and, you
and know, daddy and misses her, you yeah, know, because... Yeah, yeah. You know, daddy's showing that he misses her and that he's sad. And again, that means it's okay for me.
And I think that it's important to say that you're more, that you are a man. Men do cry.
Absolutely.
You know, one of the Bible verses I think about is when you think about Jesus, the two words that come across the shortest verse is Jesus wept.
Yep.
And he was the greatest, you know, man ever, you know, God in the flesh. And if he cried and felt pain in that, you know, and he's the greatest example of what, you know, what a man would be, then it's okay for me to cry, right?
Mm-hmm. And he was weeping in that moment because
of a death.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I literally could spend all day with you, and maybe a week and maybe a month, but... Is there anything that you're kind of sitting with right now that you think is important to be said, or you wish you would have known, or you feel that we haven't addressed? Again, we could do series of this.
Probably a play on what Fraser said earlier about asking questions, or I know because of my son's situation and the kind of ongoing chaos for 11 years that we experienced, that I was realizing when he was saying, what are those questions that people don't ask, that there are a lot of questions. I'm realizing a lot of questions, you know. I mean, all
we
the
need
way.
That book.
Yeah, we need that book.
I'll start typing.
Yeah, how do we start writing this book?
You know, asking the questions of, you know, what do you remember about your son? You know, what did you love about him? Everybody knows what we had a hard time with. That was pretty public. But, you know, I think there's a fear there. I mean, no one has ever, people know that he passed away, that the medical examiner had him, he had an autopsy, and his body was released for cremation. No one has ever asked us if we actually went and saw his body, which no one in the family except my wife and I know we did.
Right.
We actually did go spend an hour with him. And, you know, it's, I think there's just so much fear around when someone's grieving not to engage a little bit. I mean, listening is important too, but, I think another thing, like for our experience, was, you know, he died at 26 unexpectedly. We had a lot of hopes and dreams about him overcoming his issues and having somewhat of a normal life. And because he never did that, there's a lot of, you know, guilt, a lot of regret, a lot of shame, a lot of things like that. And, you know, it'd be nice for people to just acknowledge sometimes that we did the best we could and that, you know, Colin's journey ended the way it did for a reason, and that we don't have anything to be ashamed of or regretful for. Not that that's not gonna happen, but you know, I think just maybe in general, just don't be afraid. Our memories of Colin are our most treasured assets now about him. And it's really nice to be asked about him and to be able to remember those stories. My wife and I do that with each other, but, you know, I'd have other family do that, have our kids, our friends, just kind of say, hey, what memories have you had about something? Or maybe it's one of those things where I just need to be less afraid to share some memories as they happen, that something reminds us of Colin. And we go, hey, remember when Colin, you know, did such and such? Like April Fool's was my son's favorite day. And my wife and I got up this morning and just said, you know, it used to be we needed to check the faucets before we turned them on in the on April Fool's Day, or we needed to check that Oreo cookie because it might have might have toothpaste in it, or, you know. And those are just wonderful, happy memories that, you know.
I'm going to use that one today. Or the toothpaste and the Oreo
cookie.
My
Oreo.
Kids will love that one.
They will.
Yeah. So
you go to the faucet one.
I know. I actually recounted it to my youngest daughter, and she was like, I got in so much trouble. I tried to do the same thing, and I thought I was going to get Colin, and Mom went up to the sink and turned it on, and it sprayed her. No, I'm rambling, but I think there's just there is so much taboo. It's like, yeah, our loved one has died. My son has died, but he's not dead. He's still alive in a lot of ways. And I want to share that. I like sharing that. And people shouldn't be afraid to be willing to have that shared with them.
Absolutely. And we see that sometimes, or I hear that from other folks, maybe if, you know, the death was maybe related to drugs and alcohol or suicide or homicide. I think people tend to sometimes stick back because of that. But you brought up the truth is we're all at some point that squishy little baby. And at some point, Colin was that. And Colin had other things outside of his struggles. I'm a homicide survivor, and people don't know what to do with that. They don't like that. So because of the type of death, they'll tend to stay away altogether. And it's like, no, come back. There's all these other years and days that are beautiful, that are worth sharing.
Right.
So I appreciate you sharing that. Anything else that you feel like we need to say or you wish you would have known?
Yeah, if it's two quick things I can mention. The first thing that comes to mind is seeds. You know, we're planting seeds here. The one thing that has brought us all together in this room in this moment is our grief and our love for those who we lost, right? None of us planned on being here. we would schedule a million other things than to be in this moment right now. But because we are here, we have an opportunity to share the stories of those amazing, amazing people that we lost. And that's our gift back to them, is that someone is going to be able to hear this. If it's just one person,
that's right,
who can identify with one of our, someone who maybe have lost kids, young kids, mm-hmm. lost a spouse, lost a parent, lost a son, and, you know, with a whole future in front of them, they will be able to identify, you know, with what we've learned and what we've shared, and that's going to help them. So we're planting seeds today, mm-hmm. and that's one of the things that I would say that, you know, I wish I knew, is that everything that I've experienced from this grief is an opportunity to plant the seed of love and hope and recovery and healing. You know, the second thing is that people are watching you, even when you don't think that they're watching you. In my circumstance, I didn't know it was a big deal for me to continue to wear my ring, mm-hmm. right? I didn't know it was a certain group that was, okay, how long is he going to continue mm-hmm. to wear his ring?
Yes.
And then when I took off the ring, I didn't know it was another section yes. of the group that was like, oh, wow, he yes. took off his ring. So yes. now, and I'm oblivious to both right. sides of that.
Because you're being you.
Because I'm being me.
Right.
But it's like, okay, so does this mean that he's at this stage now? Right. Does it mean that he's still in this area? And I'll wrap up by saying this. I had this. I don't want to call it a dream because I was awake, but I was in a moment with LaShawn last night listening to our playlist. Mm-hmm. And I just envisioned her being in heaven at a gate, almost like she's looking down into my life. And I felt like if, you know, I'm full disclosure, you know, I'm engaged now. You know, I found a wonderful woman who had her own grief journey and we connected. And so I have a chance at, you know, forever love again. And, you know, I felt like I pray all the time to God, and also I talk to LaShawn about, you know, how she would feel and how she feels about this. And I felt like my biggest gift to her is to allow her to get up from the gate looking at me to make sure I'm okay so she can walk back and enjoy heaven. Because as long as she's waiting at that gate to make sure I'm okay, you know, it's going to take away from her journey, you know. And maybe that's just my way of processing it, but I feel like she's within me and we're still together moving forward. So we still have these conversations, about how I move forward. But my challenge and my gift to her is to continue to live, you know, continue to laugh, yeah. continue to love, and continue to learn that I don't know it all and I'm never going to know it all. And that's just what her legacy was to me, and that's going to be my legacy moving forward.
That's a beautiful thing. I think about with my mom the same way, in that I want to love people a little bit more, right? You want to be kinder to people. Mm-hmm. You want to be able to treat people better and that. And I feel like I can honor mom through that legacy. Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful thing, Michael.
It's not easy, though.
No.
Because
it's not.
And it's not always pretty.
Yeah. I got a lot of people that would have opinions and Ooh. Judgments. And one thing about men too, and I know we can talk, but the thing about men that I'm learning is that, you know, people think that men get past it quicker yes. too. And I think that's a wrong assumption.
Yes.
You know, we may get through it differently,
yes,
but we don't get past it any more quickly. No. And we're not, you know, yeah, there's a lot of things out there that people don't. I'm going to take a cue from you. There's certain things I'm just going to leave it there. Right? I'll leave it there for part two.
That's right, baby. That's right.
I have had women say, what do men know that we don't know? Because they get over this so much faster. And I'm like, oh, stop. Please stop. No, no, no. They don't have it easier. They don't have it better. They don't have the answers. Stop.
Men are human too.
Exactly.
Another chapter in the book.
There you go. That's a great, yes, that's the whole reason we're doing this.
Yeah.
Men are human too. They have feelings. Yes. If you zipped it and listened, you might find out. Yeah. Well, we could do part two and part three, and I'm extremely grateful for your honesty, your vulnerability. That is not lost on me. Grief is a reflection of love. And you have shared your love stories today, and men have love stories, and men are not afraid to share love stories. So I appreciate so much you sharing about your mom and Colin, Mila and Elle and LaShawn. I do believe very much that the love that they've given you in your lives, you put that out on the table for everyone today. And so I very much am just very humbled by your willingness to share your love. So thank you to each of you. And we'll probably have to continue this another time.
Good.
Sounds great.
Sounds okay. Good.
Yeah.
Grief does heal. Let me say that again. Grief does heal. I say that every episode because grief does heal. However, it demands attention and care, as we've learned here today. Grief also needs support and patience that we've heard here today. Remember that you're not alone. The world is certainly full of grievers like us. You can learn more about us at www.baptistgriefcenters.org. You can follow us on our YouTube channel at Baptist Centers for Good Grief. Our next podcast will be available where you get your podcast. And remember, grief is real, big, and better shared. We'll talk soon.